So this dude just called me today. Don't come around here no more. Don't nobody want to be out west. But anyway, I just got fucking metric and standard ratchet wrenches. Fucking one was a 14 cent standard and a 16 cent metric. And then I wish I could show them to you, but I came up on another ratchet set. I think it was a 24 piece. It had a couple unique pieces in there, in the back there. But it's weird, like the ratchet set is hollow, so you could slide it onto like what my mind goes to is like plumbing, when you know you do them wires, but how do you get it off? I don't know. Oh, maybe it's to go on top of. I don't know. I've never seen no shit like this. Anyway, we're out west. I fixed his alternator one winter, and he's got like fucking 18 cars, like 6 cars, and he's like, bro, he texted me 2 days ago, he said, bro, look at these tools, will you come go buy an alternator from AutoZone, and when you come here, I'll give you the money. And I'm like, damn, I gotta go buy the motherfucker too? He's like, yeah, but I'll give you the money right when you come here, and then you can take the core back, and you can get the little money for the alternator core. I'm like, all right, that's good money, because that's like $20-$30 gas. And then he gave me extra 20, so I got $50 cash, and I got an amazing amount of tools. Just to put a fucking, on a Caprice Classic, an alternator. You know how easy that was? That took me 5 minutes. The alternator was so available to my hands. It was right there on top of the motor. The serpentine belt came off with a ratchet and a pipe for leverage. And, I needed the pipe to get the bolt off. But I was like, how come my cars aren't ever this quick to fucking fix? He's like, because you ain't got old Chevys and shit. I'm like, you're damn right. Impalas and them old Chevys and shit, man, they had so much fucking, you know, they had a big block stuck in there, a lot of them, and V8s and shit. But I can fix those cars. These new shits, man, I could probably switch out a motherfucker if I got the motherfucking, this is the west side. What street am I on, Holman or some shit? Adams, but this is kind of the calm down part of the west side, I think, but it's so wild out here. It's kind of cold, nobody's out. But, I'm driving through Chicago, like always. The west side is revival. The west side is starting to look better. They're pumping money into it. White people are thinking they're going to buy a property, and they're going to get rid of all the heroin addicts. And drug spots and crack spots and games, turf, and their $100,000 investment is going to be worth $1 million in 3 years. They might have to wait a little while longer, but I think they will profit on their investment. These buildings to my right and left here, I mean, you could probably pick them up for $1.50. Like these old brown brick apartments. But see, those are things you gotta rent out as an apartment unless you sell it. And you don't want to rent shit out because you constantly got to renovate. So that's not a very good investment plan. This one right here is a two unit. That's not one whole house. So you got, you know what I mean? You're not renting to one family. And by the way, if you were renting to two families, you would get two Section 8 incomes, which would be $2,000 instead of max $1,400 from the state. So I guess it would be good, but you'd constantly have to renovate two units. You'd have to gut it right the first time, because if you don't fix it right, it's going to be ruined quicker. But then if you gut it really nice the first time and it gets wrecked, all that work you did to make it real nice gets fucked over. So if I were these people, I would buy them, and you would have to sit on them. You could rent them out in the meantime, but you're basically just going to make them like livable for a couple years and get that rent income and pay that property tax and shit like that and add it to your equity, and then hope that one day that the neighborhood becomes trendy. And there are a couple spots right off of the train stops where people like hipsters or young professionals can think to themselves, well, all I gotta do is walk one block to the train. I don't even have to own a car to live in Chicago and work downtown. It makes sense to me. Here's $250,000 for this home. Now, they're not gonna be living in that neighborhood for 2 weeks prior to signing. They're gonna be able to drive around and check it out, but they're not gonna know the annoyances. Unless a lot of people are standing out, gangbanging, chilling, kicking it, open air drug market, they're not gonna see that shit. It's gonna be the little shit that they don't notice till it's too late. The West Side is not a 100% guaranteed investment. The South Side's even worse. There's parts of the South Side that will never be gentrified or ungentrified or whatever you wanna call it. They will never be trendy. I mean, but this area right here, you see these buildings on the other side of this viaduct? See these buildings to my left? From this viaduct all the way to the next viaduct are all new buildings, right? Those used to be called, there's one in the distance that they left up. If you could see it, that was one of the Rockwell projects. This whole strip was projects. Those right there, those they're almost orange bricked. Those used to be open air projects. No security, no gate around them, and them windows are all new. That shit was all projects. And now it's not. And that's pretty close to downtown. I mean, look, we ain't but 5 minutes away from the Loop. Yeah, you could buy some property over there that it's an old mansion made out of limestone. The walls are fucking 3 foot thick at the base. And you might make a killing. Then again, you know, there's probably a lot of realty groups and a lot of money has to be invested. All the hardwood floors probably have to be raised. You have to do all the drywall bullshit work. A lot of them are old plaster and lattice or whatever you call that shit. It's not like it's just drywall and 2x4 studs. It's like plaster speckled onto these, they're like 1.25 inch wide, or maybe 1/4 inch width by 1.25 inch by, I don't know, 4 foot long or 6 foot long, and they just put them up like, you know, if you see an old scary movie and light shines through the movie like in Hellraiser, there's little slits in between and the light just pierces through because those are how the old homes are built.
A beacon of hope in
humanity. It's not 2x4s so framed with drywall. They're all plastic. Sleep. I normally and you're either going to have to take that all out or
they can't get enough.
And the ceilings,
right,
to get the plaster to actually hang on the ceiling, they couldn't just spackle it onto those wooden slats or whatever you want to call them. It's basically like if you took lattice and broke them down and lined them up horizontally or lined them up next to each other with a gap in between of about 1/2 inch. Okay? But the spackle's not gonna hold to the ceiling. So they would literally have to put grated metal, like almost like jail door metal, where there's more metal than there is open air, you know, to look through, or chicken wire. Very thick gauged chicken wire. I've demolished some of these. Oh man, it's a nightmare. Tearing down them old fucking plaster ceilings, and you gotta get on a fucking ladder and tear that shit down from your on top of your head. There's a cool Art Deco building up here that has a three-dimensional look to it on the left-hand side that I like how it looks. I don't usually like Art Deco and that whole style, and I'm not even sure that that's the correct style for this look they went for, or maybe it was a restored building. All these to the left all used to be lofts. See those three right there? They all used to be warehousing space turned into residential. They threw a fucking couple fucking I-beam, or what are those called? Like rebar, set it in the wall, and then they had themselves a motherfucking patio. This is one of my favorite Stones songs. I don't like the Stones that much, but I do like the way this sounds. It sounds like a good Vietnam song, right? Love, it's just a kiss away. The building's up here on the left. straight ahead is the post office they used in The Dark Knight. You drive under that building. Here's the building I'm talking about. Only a part of it's an Art Deco painting. Look, it's got a three-dimensional look to it. See that right there, center screen? See that orange inlay that tries to make it look 3D? That's been there for 100 years. And then there's motifs all around it of grain manufacturing. Motifs. We're not gonna go under the building because we gotta go right. We gotta go back to the south side. Look at this, this is a nightmare. What do I do? I've been watching a lot of, what's his name? I would really like to give you the name of him. Maybe I'll find it and put it in the description at a later time. Mark Felton, I believe his name could be. His World War II documentaries are a classy work. And he doesn't take a side, he just presents the facts. He doesn't try to whitewash the United States as this perfect knight in shining armor coming to liberate, nor does he demonize all of Germany, you know, so forth, so on and so forth. And I was just thinking, man, them motherfucking boys, them Germans who got caught marching to Moscow and got stuck in that Moscow winter, that Russian winter in Leningrad as well. And then, you know, the officers weren't murdered on the spot. They were drugged back east of Moscow and put in prison camps. Oh man, what a fucking fate. You think you're about to fucking take over all of Europe proper, along with the world for that matter. You're a highly decorated officer. You've been through many valiant efforts of the fights of invading Normandy, crossing the Somme into Paris, victory in Paris, driving through Paris. What that must have been like for the Germans in World War II. They must have felt like they were on top of the world. The euphoria, only to have everything on this world that's dear to you snatched and taken. And that means your family and the fates of your family back home. And then the campaign of firebombing the cities at night. The British and United States, we firebombed civilians to make the Germans. And then the Germans were such assholes. I swear at times when I look at the World War II, Goebbels, the propaganda minister, along with Hitler, their goal, once they realized defeat, or maybe even the goal all along, was to kill as many Germans as possible. Because they put over the radio something called a werewolf. They spelled it with a V, but they opened it up with a wolf howling. They called them the werewolves. And that meant we are going to fight down to every last man. What effect did this have on the invading Allied forces? You cannot trust any German citizen. So when you went into these cities, they were killing, so all the werewolf experiment did, it didn't cause any too many American casualties or scare America too much. The howling unnerved them, because they did listen to the howl, and then it was translated, and the Americans were played it, but all it did was get more young men killed. They had just lost World War I, and now World War I was a war fought in trenches out on the countryside. And when it was over, Germany had to pay economically, and they went into a deep depression because of losing the war and because of economics. But their cities were intact. And it was a war against most of the prisoners of war were taken in by Britain and the United States, treated well, and repatriated to Germany. World War II, the bodies froze by the thousands in the Russian winter. critical miscalculations. And I'm not saying we'd live in a better world had they won. Because I might not be able. I know that they lost and I'm alive. So I don't know if World War One went the other way, would I be alive? So from a completely selfish point of view, I'm good with how it went. I don't like the way women and children were treated. I don't like... See, when men don't think they have to pay any penalty for murder and rape, they do things they wouldn't naturally do. And men don't understand that if your officer does not show restraint, if the officer in charge does not show restraint and keep his men in line, they will go crazy. And these people, the Americans, were not kept in line in a lot of cases. They were allowed to do whatever they wanted. And then they would, you know, they would act according to how the next man acted. If the next man acted with respect and kindness and care towards the civilian population, because people don't understand how much what other people do around them affects their behavior. If everybody's out here got a pistol on them, you're not going to want to be the only one without one. If everybody out here is a tough guy, it might make you, you know, a harder nut to crack. You might form, you know, have a harder exterior. Because everybody around here, I've been noticing, walks around with a mean mug. You know, you can't talk to men like on a different level, like man to man. People get offended, leaning on their feelings. But yeah, I came up on some cool tools. I'm gonna make a video about them. That was the point of this video. But I'm making a lot of videos lately. Just making a lot of videos for this channel. Even though I have no subs, I think I enjoy making the videos. And if somebody ever watches them, cool, great. But just making a cash. Another cache of videos. Everybody out there, God bless. Love the one you're with. Remember the golden rule. Do unto others as you would have done unto you. Kindness, love, all that good shit. That's what makes the world go round. I know it for a fact. You know, God don't like ugly. And men, we need to be on each other's side. I'm going to start encouraging people, my brothers. Uplift them. Iron sharpens iron. All right, peace.